to think that I could not go on, and life was nothing but an awful song. But now I know the meaning of true love, 'cause I am leaning on the everlasting arms. If I can see it, then I can do it. If I just believe it, then there's nothing to it. I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it every night and day. Spread my wings and fly away. I believe I can soar. I see me running through that open door. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. See, I was on the verge of breaking down. Sometimes silence can seem so loud, 'cause there are miracles in life I must achieve. But first I know it starts inside of me. Oh, oh, if I can see it, then I can be it. If I just believe it, then there's nothing to it. Oh, I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it every night and day. Spread my wings and fly away. And I believe I can soar. I see me running through that open door. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. If I can see it, then I can do it. If I just believe it, then there's nothing to it. Oh, I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it every night and day. Spread my wings and fly away. And I believe I can soar. I see me running through that open door. I believe I can fly. And I believe I can fly. And I believe I can fly. If I just spread my wings, I can fly. I can fly. If I just spread my wings, I can fly. I can fly. I can fly. I can fly. I can fly.
Thank you. We're called to worship in the words of Isaiah 12. Surely God is my salvation, I will trust and will not be afraid. For the Lord God is my strength and my might, he has become my salvation. With joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation, and you will say in that day, give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known his deeds among the nations, proclaim that his name is exalted. Let us sing to the thanksgiving of God. Come, Christians, join to sing hymn 150. All who are able may stand as we sing together.
We live in the land of the free, sweet land of liberty, and yet we're thoughtless in doing things that limit the rights and freedoms of others. We have so much, yet we spend so much on ourselves. So let us ask for God's mercy and forgiveness using the familiar words of the penitent King David when he realized the gravity of his sins. We will follow with a time of silent personal confession. Let us pray together. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. Amen. The prophet Isaiah relays this word from God. I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind. Know that in Christ our sins are forgotten. We are forgiven. We are a new creation. Thanks be to God.
You are the Lord, giver of mercy.
participating today. As the session met this Sunday morning, it was our privilege to receive into the life and fellowship of First Presbyterian Church, a family with roots here at First Presbyterian. It's my pleasure now to invite them forward as they come forward. Mr. and Mrs. Donald Kenneth Allen, Don and Carol, and their two daughters, Jennifer Ann and Kimberly Jane, or by Jennifer and Kimberly. Don and Carol were married here at First Presbyterian Church. This was Carol's home congregation. They are to be received by transfer letter from First Presbyterian Church of Lenoir, North Carolina. Don is employed by the State of North Carolina Office of the Secretary of Health and Human Services, and Carol is an RN. Jennifer is a senior, and Kimberly a sophomore at North Carolina State University. So we're thankful for this family who joined with us this day and come back to the roots. As you have been received into the membership of this congregation as you met with the session this Sunday morning, you come acknowledging your faith in Jesus Christ. As we received you, we acknowledge, too, the oneness of the body of Christ around the world, for we are members of the one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. And because of this, you did not come to us as strangers, but as a brother and sisters in the Lord. The sense of unity is reflected in the epistle to the Ephesians in the fourth chapter, where the writer, Paul, reminds us there is one body and one spirit, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of us all, who is above all and through all and in all. I address this one question to you. Do you promise to be a faithful member of this congregation, giving of yourself in every way, and by so doing, fulfilling your calling as a disciple of Jesus Christ the Lord? We'll respond by saying, I do. Thank you.
Well, let us pray. Gracious God, we give thanks for your calling the Allens home to our church after distinguishing themselves at First Presbyterian in Lenoir. Thankful for Don and Carol and Jennifer and Kimberly. May we all grow in your spirit to love one another and to have the mind of Jesus Christ our Lord, whom we give honor and glory forever. Amen.
As Bob is presenting to our new members their certificates, I invite you to come forward at the close of the service. Camille Lamb is the elder sponsor. As you come forward, please introduce yourselves to Camille, and she in turn will introduce you to Don and Carol and Jennifer and Kimberly. Welcome.
Carol.
Okay. Young ladies.
Support him.
Kim. Thank you. It's also our privilege now to participate in the sacrament of baptism. Mr. and Mrs. John Rogers, John and Amy, present their infant son, John Mason Rogers, for the sacrament of baptism, and the elder representing the congregation is Elder Jim Nichols. We're thankful for all of you being here today and for family and friends being here who are sitting on the first several pews of the congregation. Let us hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you, and lo, I'm with you always to the close of the age. In Jesus Christ, God has promised to forgive our sins and has joined us together in the family of faith, which is his church. God has delivered us from darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. In Jesus Christ, God has promised to be our Father, to welcome us as brothers and sisters of Christ. John and Amy know that the promises of God are for you and for your children. By baptism, God puts his sign on you to show that all of you belong to him and gives you Holy Spirit as a guarantee that sharing Christ's work, you will also share in his victory. That dying with Christ to sin, you and your children will be raised with him to new life.
Amy and Jack, in presenting John Mason for baptism, you announce your faith in Jesus Christ, and you show that you want John Mason to study him, to know him, and to serve him as his chosen disciple. So would you show your purpose by answering these questions? Who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior.
Do you trust in him?
Yes.
And do you intend for John Mason to be his disciple, to obey his word, and to show his love?
Our Lord Jesus Christ ordered us to teach those who are baptized. Do you, the people of the church, promise to tell this new disciple, John Mason Rogers, the good news of the gospel, to help him know all that Christ commands, and by your fellowship to strengthen his family ties with the household of God? The congregation will respond by saying, we do.
We do.
We do.
Let us pray. Precious God, we thank you for your faithfulness promised in this sacrament and for the hope we have in your Son, Jesus. As we baptize with water, baptize us with Holy Spirit, so that what we say may be your word and what we do may be your work. By your power, may we be made one with Christ our Lord in common faith and purpose, in whose name we pray. Amen. What is the full name of the child?
John Mason Rogers.
John Mason Rogers, child of the covenant. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest and abide with you both now and forevermore. Amen. We have witnessed the baptism of John Mason Rogers, as he has been received into the Holy Catholic Church, the universal church of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We have witnessed, and thus we become extensions of his family. We too become aunts and uncles and grandparents and cousins and brothers and sisters. We become channels of God's grace, whereby he may claim these promises given for him this day by his parents when he confirms his faith in Jesus Christ, because he will know of God's love as that love comes through you, his Savior, Jesus Christ. Present him to you now. Okay.
Do you want to walk with me?
You want to walk with me?
We'll go with his brother.
Here are some people you know. Oh, okay, you're waking up now. In the Acts of the Apostles, Peter's preaching and says, repent and be baptized, for the promise is to you and to all your children and to all who are far off. And the word promise refers to the covenant. We are a covenant people, and so we baptize both children and adults, symbolizing that in our weakness, the Spirit of God comes to us to bring us to faith. In our weakness, the power of God claims us, enabling us to know of love, love of family, love of our Lord, and love which comes in all the living of life and all of its preciousness. So at this Thanksgiving season, we have much to be thankful for this day as we celebrate the baptism of young John Mason. Jack, you did well. You did well.
Let us pray. Almighty God, giver of life, you have called us by name and pledged to each of us your faithful love. We pray for your child, John Mason Rogers. Watch over him, guide him as he grows in faith. Give him understanding and a genuine concern for neighbor, that he may become a true disciple of Jesus Christ. We pray your blessing on his brother Will Stevens and his parents, Amy and Jack, and his grandmother, and especially his great-grandmother, Santina Saponari, who came all the way from New Jersey for this blessed day. Help them all to be good watchdogs of young John Mason and to help him grow in faith. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Let us stand for our baptismal response.
Boy, even the socks.
Good morning and welcome to worship at First Presbyterian. I invite you now to participate in a ritual of friendship. The friendship pads along the center aisle. Please take those and sign them and pass them along the pew as you observe the names of those in worship with you this Sunday morning. Special welcome to all our guests, those of you here for the baptism, and those others of you who are here worshiping with us this Sunday morning. If you're looking for a church home, we invite you to join with us in Christian discipleship. We have been serving our Lord from this location since 1816, and folks come from all over Wake County and beyond. And it's an exciting place to be in ministry. If you'd like information about the church, there's a place to check on the friendship call, pad, interest in receiving information, or in receiving a visit. And if you'd like to speak with someone after the service, there will be an officer in this room to my right who is prepared to talk with you about how one does become a member of this community of faith, the body of Christ. Also in this room is a Stephen minister. We are a Stephen ministry congregation. If you have a concern to be shared, that individual is ready to receive it. In the pews, a lavender cards for prayer requests. We have a very active intercessory prayer group. And if you have a prayer request, you may place that in the offering plate or in one of the wooden boxes in the vestibules, the entranceways into the sanctuary. At the close of the service, there will be coffee and fellowship in Balkan Paula. After Bob and I greet at the doors, we will go there. And if you're sitting next to some visitors this morning, please invite them to the Balkan Paula, and we look forward to greeting you there. The next orientation classes begin on Sunday, December the 2nd, and will continue for 3 weeks. As Bob indicated during the announcements, I shall be with my family outside of Memphis, Tennessee, Collierville, in fact. I look forward to eating lots of pecan pie. I'm trying not to eat much now, so when I go there, I can feast. And it will be a feast as we join family, children, grandchildren. And we wish all of you a very, very wonderful Thanksgiving if we do not see you here Tuesday evening for the Thanksgiving supper and worship service. We have a special occasion now to honor those who are recipients of catechism awards. Many years ago, a lady in the church by the name of McEwen gave an endowment to encourage young people to say the catechism. And with the stock market, this amount of money has grown. And so we're having a hard time giving away. And we'd like to have many, many more young people say the catechism. So this time we shall ask them to come forward with their parents. I need to get my book again. And request that K.C. Crawley also join me. Ken and Cynthia Gwynn with their children, Amy and David Gwynn. These are the West right here. Holly West is with Bennett West. Hopkins, Kathy is here with son Tyler. Nelson and Susan Johnson here with Brian. Richard and Carol Mooring are here with Jenna Mooring, and James and Nancy Ricks are here with their son, John Ricks. The Presbyterian Church and the Reformed body has had catechisms to help both children and adults learn to articulate their faith. And it's very important for us because faith through understanding was a hallmark of John Calvin in terms of how we express the biblical faith we believe. And so we learn the language of faith, and the catechism helps us to learn this language. And above this is even the Westminster Shorter Catechism, which if you say it in college and you go to a Presbyterian college and you write a short paper, only 2,000 words, you get a grant of $1,000. This is an encouragement to learn to express the faith. So we're thankful that you have learned and recited to your teacher, Betty Ann Dorman, the Child's Catechism. And we honor you this Sunday morning. And we have a gift from the church to present to you. Has everyone received their gift? Did we leave anyone out? Raise your hand. Okay, let us have a prayer. Gracious God, we are thankful for the opportunity to study and to learn because the use of our minds is a spiritual discipline. You've given us potentialities of mind, heart, and will, and faith. And we're thankful that as we exercise all these together, we may live to serve you and to glorify you in all the issues of life. So we ask your blessing on these families and these young people who have recited and have learned some basic elements of Christian theology and faith. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Again, congratulations to all of you.
Congregation's invited to stand at this time as we sing a classic hymn. Pay attention to the words. Dr. Stock's going to refer to it in his sermon this morning. We Gather Together, number 559. Let us stand and sing. Let us pray for illumination. Gracious God, your word is eternal and fresh as the morning. Speak to us a special word this morning where we are, that we may hear a new word in Scripture that will remind us of your presence with us on our journey of faith. Dear Lord, give us ears to hear. Amen.
Cal Parks could not be with us this morning, so I will be reading our Old Testament lesson. It's taken from the book of Isaiah in chapter 65, selected verses 17 through 20 and 24 and 25. Let us hear the word of the Lord. For I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating, for I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. But before they call, I will answer, and while they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox, but the serpent, its food shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy on my holy mountain, says the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our gospel lesson for this Sunday, along with the lesson just read, is from the Gospel of Luke, the 21st chapter, verses 5 through 19. Hear now God's word to us. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, he said, meaning Jesus, as for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another, all will be thrown down. They asked him, Teacher, when will this be? And what will be the sign that this is about to take place? And he said, Beware that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name and say, I am he, and the time is near. Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately. Then he said to them, Nation will rise up against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places famines and plagues, and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance. For I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name. But not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls. The gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, as we come into this Thanksgiving season, we are mindful of the days through which we are living. And there doesn't seem to be much which is permanent in which we can latch onto for security. But enable us to hear afresh these words of Scripture from Isaiah 65 and from the Gospel of Luke. Thus may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I must admit that my psyche was more bruised than I thought when I heard about what happened to American Flight 587, because I was still reeling from all the events of September the 11th and the craziness of everything which has taken place. And the media thought I had when I heard about it on, I think it came by way of a member of the staff who had heard it on the radio, and then some folks dashed it to see CNN. The media thing which struck me was not again, meaning not another terrorist attack. Current evidence, though tragic, fortunately does not point to that reality. It was a terrible, terrible accident. If you can, you know, accident, metal fatigue, whatever. But still, I and many of us were still rattled. What was considered normal prior to September the 11th is no longer normal now. Institutions and things we put our trust in as giving us a sense of security and permanence are no longer secure. The message in our gospel lesson is a troubling one, yet at the end of it, Jesus gives a word of encouragement to his disciples after he goes through this litany of all these ominous things which are going to happen. Things in their life which gave them a firm foundation, particularly as they looked at the temple. For that, to them, gave them a sense of security and permanence. After all, if you could see the temple, all was right. Jesus gives us the assurance of divine power when things considered so permanent and strong are brought down as rubble, fall to the earth, or can infect our biological systems. Today, we hear these words. And we can give thanksgiving to God that there is indeed this spiritual strength to give us perseverance and endurance. Jesus says to his disciples then, as he has said to the disciples in the church down through the centuries, as he says to us this Sunday morning, not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls. So the focus of our sermon this morning, as we hear the dual lessons from Isaiah 65 and from the Gospel of Luke, is this. God in Jesus Christ is the only source for divine strength to persevere and to endure. And we must trust in God. We must have faith. We as human beings cannot generate this from inside of us. In our finiteness, we cannot generate the power to endure and to persevere. We give up. It is human nature. The spiritual power to cope with the troubling transiency of things in this earth can only come from beyond ourselves. Spiritual perseverance and endurance comes to us as a gift. When Jesus says, by your endurance, you will gain your souls, the Greek word for endurance is epimone. In the classical Greek, it's a word to describe a sword which can withstand hard blows. A sword which can withstand hard blows. The spiritual power in us, which comes to us a gift from our Lord Jesus Christ, gives us the spiritual capability to withstand life's hard blows, epimone. The New Testament scholar Philip H. Manon reminds us that because of the spirit of the crucified and risen Lord in us, nothing in this world can destroy what is inside of us as a gift. Not a hair on your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls because of the gift inside of each one of us, which the Apostle Paul describes as a treasure in an earthen vessel, or as some translations has, as a treasure in clay jars. Because of this gift inside of us, nothing in this world can take that away from us. By our baptisms, we have the mark of the crucified and risen Lord in our souls as a gift. We have a spiritual sword inside of us, which gives us the spiritual capacities in the midst of life's transiency, in the midst of all the things which are changing, which we once thought could give us permanence and security. We have inside of us this power to withstand life's hard blows. Our gospel lesson begins with a very innocent statement by bystanders. What a beautiful temple. Look at all those stones. Why, it looks so permanent looking, so beautiful. After all, it's dedicated to God. Jesus says to them, as for these things you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down. And if you know Jewish history, the Roman Jewish War 67 through 70, that indeed happened. If you go to Rome and go into the Forum, you see Hadrian's Arch, and inside of Hadrian's Arch is depicted in relief fashion the Roman soldiers carting off the contents of the Jewish temple. Not one stone will be left. It was rubble. But yet, at the end of the discourse, Jesus gives a word of encouragement that in the midst of all of this, we can have faith and trust because there is something inside of us which no one can ever take away from us. And he's implying, trust in me, believe in me, have faith. Not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your soul. At Thanksgiving, we sing a lot of Thanksgiving hymns, and one of them we sang this day, Now Thank We All. We gather together, excuse me, we sang that last week. We gather together, and I've been singing We Gather Together for a long, long time, since I was a child. And it's been a hymn in the Presbyterian Reformed tradition for centuries. It's out of the tradition, the religious heritage of the Dutch. Did you notice the hymn date? Now, people complain we don't sing enough old hymns. Well, friends, this hymn goes back to 1625. It's an old, old hymn. The hymn dates from a period right in the middle of the 80-year war of religious and political persecution which the Dutch had to live through in the provinces today we call Holland. In this period, Holland, mainly Protestant and Reformed Presbyterian, was aligned with the French Huguenots in France. And as you know, the French Huguenots were French Presbyterians. Young Frederick Henry, Prince of Orange, who later became the political, spiritual, and military leader of the Netherlands, was born 6 months before his father was assassinated on January 29, 1584. His father had a very interesting name, if you study history, William the Silent. Must not have been very, you know, loquacious, to put a fancy term. It wasn't, you know. But anyway, he's called William the Silent. Young Henry's mother was a young mother, the fourth wife of William the Solid. The other wives had died. Her name was Louise de Coligny. She was a French Huguenot. The daughter of the French Huguenot leader, Admiral de Coligny. And these were perilous times for members of the Presbyterian Reformed family in Europe because of the tremendous power and the might of Catholic Spain. You remember your history. On St. Bartholomew's Day in Paris on August the 24th, 1577, French Protestants and Catholics gathered to celebrate a wedding which somehow could bring an alliance and a truce. But a conspiracy had been hatched by certain Catholic leaders and Admiral de Coligny, and 8,000 French Huguenots were slaughtered on St. Bartholomew's Day in Paris. And 6 to 7 times that number were killed all over France in a matter of days. The date of this hymn, 1625, coincides with the coming to leadership of young Frederick Henry, 31 years of age, written in the midst of nothing which was permanent except faith. Nothing was permanent except faith. And we gather together as a hymn which reminds us that though we die, we have won from the very beginning. Because there is a power from beyond the grave, which is a gift inside of us, which nothing in this world can take away from us. Accepting Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior gives us a future inheritance, which enables us to be thankful in the present no matter what we live through. This is why Thanksgiving is so important. When you sit around and hold hands, there's nothing so precious as a family member. I feel sorry for individuals in nursing homes who have outlived family. Hopefully an aide will come in or a nurse will come in and hold hands or hold and let them know that they're loved. Nothing can give us security but one's faith. Accepting Jesus Christ empowers us in the present. And so we sang, so from the beginning, the fight we were winning, Thou, Lord, was on our side, all glory be thine. We give thanksgiving to God at this season of the year because in no circumstances are we ever, ever abandoned. Never. Even though things we considered permanent, things which gave us security, have fallen. Not a hair on your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls. Our Old Testament lesson from 65 is known as 3rd Isaiah, written at the time of the return of the Jews from captivity in Babylon. Remember, Jerusalem fell in 587. Things were not going well. The Jews had been back for 50 years, had a shabby temple, no city walls, rubble in the street. It was drab in colors. Things were chaotic out in the countryside. And Isaiah, inspired by the Holy Spirit, gives us vision of an eschatological hope, meaning something from the future which can shape the present, for which they can be thankful. When everything around them was lacking of permanence and security, Isaiah gives an assurance of a future hope which can transcend the transiency of things in the present. And what Isaiah envisions is not just a new Jerusalem of brick and mortar, but a new Jerusalem of the heart and the mind and the will. It's a vision for humankind which transcends even the Jews because of divine intervention, which can enable those of us who live in the here and the now to put aside animosity and bitterness and hatred and hopelessness. The metaphor is a powerful one of transformation. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together, and the lion shall eat straw like oxen. This is a divine intervention, a transformation. And in a few weeks, we will celebrate that incarnation of the Messiah who was born at Bethlehem. Since 1991, we've been living on a mountaintop high in the United States in terms of economic development, full employment, low inflation, things which economists say can't happen. But our ancestors of faith have had to live through the valleys, and so must we. Tough times enables us not to take for granted good times. And thus we can sing this hymn at this Thanksgiving season in the aftermath of September the 11th. We all do extol thee, thou leader triumphant, and pray that thou still our defender will be. Let thy congregation escape tribulation, thy name be ever praised. Lord, make us free. Free to do what? Free, yes, to be free from anxiety and fear, because nothing in this world can take away the treasure inside of us. Freed as well to live responsibly in the here and the now as disciples. Free to defend the value of our faith. Free to defend the value of family. Free to defend the values of our country. Free to defend the worth of every human being, the poor, the powerless, who need protection by us who are advocates. Nothing in heaven on earth can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ, Paul reminds us. Yes, at this Thanksgiving season, we remember why it is that we can be thankful in the midst of life's transiency and changes. Jesus Christ is the only source of divine strength for perseverance and endurance. As Christians, we know the end of the story. We know because what flows out of Holy Scripture? And what is it? That the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ will prevail against the gates of hell, and no evil which could become incarnate in any shape or form can overcome us. Not a hair on your head will perish, and by your endurance you will gain your souls. Trust in me, Jesus is implying. Thanks be to God for the gift perseverance and endurance, which enables us to love and to care and to be responsible as disciples of our Lord Jesus Christ, both in the church and in the public domain. Amen.
Please stand at this time as we reaffirm our trust in God and say the words Christians have said for centuries, the historic Apostles' Creed. It is printed on page 14 in the hymnal. Let us affirm what we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Let us join in a time of prayer. We will conclude by saying together the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Great God, at this time of year when we thank you for all your everyday gifts, let us not forget the big gifts. Indeed, you are our Creator, our strength, our guide, our salvation. We pray that your strength will sustain those who have been weakened by the forces of the world, such as that woman in Queens, New York, where the plane crashed on Monday, just 2 months after the September 11th devastation. And she told the reporter, "I don't know if I can take any more of this." God of compassion, may she be led to your grace and mercy, and may she discover those hidden resources of strength that you've implanted in each of us. May the people of faith around her help sustain her through this time of suffering and endurance, which brings out character and leads to hope, and hope does not disappoint us. Great God, sometimes we feel so powerless, so futile in our efforts. Help us to keep praying where we don't understand, even to pray for our enemies, even if we don't know how. We continue to lift our prayers for the victims, the downtrodden in the midst of war and strife. And we pray for that glorious day of peace and reconciliation. May it blot out the backlog of evil and suffering as your compassion takes new form in our midst, as the face of God becomes present with human hands, helping, loving hands, reaching out with food and healing and hope. We pray for those here facing problems just as big in their own lives, for the ones concerned about upcoming surgery, those worried about the failing health of good friends, for people with financial problems, and for problems in family and relationships that are so hard to fix and which are about to be tested again. Lord, help us deal with what we can and to give the rest to you in faith and trust. Recreate our lives as you create new heavens and new earth. And let us not weary of doing right, as Apostle Paul encouraged us. We pray that you'll continue to bless our efforts as a church as we look for new ways to encourage each other in faith and explore new ways of ministering to the people that you bring to us who are looking for some reason to have hope, to have something to be thankful for. As we approach the Thanksgiving holiday, we pray for safe travels, for those in transit, for family reunions, to honor this marvelous tradition of being thankful for all your many blessings. We thank you for the opportunity to gather together as a church family today in Christ's name as we pray the prayer he taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The gospel lesson today, Jesus assured the disciples that when those tough times came, the Holy Spirit would give them words and wisdom and the opportunity to testify to their faith. May our tithes and offerings be testimonials to our faith and our thankfulness as we present them to God at this time.
Gracious God, we bring you our simple gifts in faith and trust that you will multiply them to do your work in faithful witness to Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Our concluding hymn is number 447, Lead On, O King Eternal.
At this Thanksgiving season, indeed, we are thankful. We carry within us the treasure in an earthen jar. And because of that, nothing in this existence can do us in. And so we celebrate the simple pleasures of love and of family, of faith, of country, and the opportunity to live on behalf of others who too are children of God in whatever circumstance of life they are in. Enable us to go out to live the faith we profess, with thanksgiving and with perseverance and endurance. And now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with each and every one of you, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Yes, well, I was afraid of it. College, good, right?
You'll try one more.